altar blazing, so let's raise our candles and light up the sky, praying to our Father.
Welcome to the Light of the Nations broadcast. It's my privilege and honor to share and to bring the Word of God with you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for yet another opportunity to come into your presence and to share your Word. I pray, Lord, that these airwaves will carry the Word of the living God and will penetrate into the hearts of the listeners and open the eyes and understanding of those who hear, Lord, that we may be able to see the truths of God's word. Even as David said, open thou mine eyes that I may behold wondrous things from thy word. May we hold this evening wondrous things from your word. We will be careful to give you all the glory, to give you all the praise, and to give you all the honor. In Jesus' most blessed and precious name we pray. Amen and amen. There is so much being said of late about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, this message has been preached for quite some time now. And it is kind of, some people think, you know, everybody's talking, but Jesus has not come. But the truth is that every word of God will be fulfilled. In the book of Revelation, chapter 22 and verse 20, Jesus specifically said, behold, I come quickly. And indeed, when we look at the signs and the times in which we live, and as we read God's word, we recognize and realize that indeed the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is very, very close. So what I would like to share this evening with you is the two comings of our Lord Jesus Christ, the time when he came the first time and the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, which has not yet been accomplished. And then also I would like to share, God willing, the two phases of Christ's second coming. If you would like to, you could also call it the two different stages of Christ coming the second time. So the first time, we know that the Lord Jesus Christ came as a man. And the second time when he comes, he will not come as a man, but he will come as God. In the first coming, we know that Jesus, when he came, there was no room in the inn for him. But when he comes a second time, his is the kingdom, the glory, and the power forever and ever. Amen. In the first coming, Jesus came as an ordinary carpenter's son. But in the second coming, he's going to come as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. In the first coming, we gave him a crown of thorns. But in the second coming, the Lord Jesus Christ will come with a royal scepter and the rod of iron to rule and to reign. In the first coming, Jesus came to establish the spiritual kingdom, his spiritual kingdom in the hearts of men and women. In the second coming, Jesus will come to establish the literal reign and rule of God on this earth. In the first coming, Jesus was judged by us, cruel and wicked and unrighteous and evil people. In the second coming, Jesus will come as the righteous judge of all. In the first, only the believers will see him. And every eye shall see him. And in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7, it says that, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is, which was, and which is to come. Amen. So in Revelation chapter 22 and 20, as I said, Jesus says, "Behold, I come quickly." The New Testament distinguishes two phases of his second coming. We're now going to talk about the two different phases of his second coming. I explained to you the first coming and the second coming, and I think the last point that I said was in reference to the two phases of his second coming. And when I said that when he comes in the first phase of his second coming, only the believers will see him. But in the second phase of his second coming, every eye will see him. So as I open God's word to you this evening about the two phases of Christ's second coming, I trust and pray that you will have your ears tuned in and your hearts also here along with God's word, so that you could actually understand and receive what God's word is trying to tell us. So in the first phase of Christ's second coming, which we have recorded for us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18, when the dead in Christ, let me read that to you. Verses chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians, verses 13 through 18. "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which sleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we be with him forever. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words." When the dead in Christ shall be raised and the living caught up to meet him in the air is the first phase of his second coming. This is referred to as the rapture, or the catching up of the church, or the catching away of the church. In his second coming, the second phase, his coming to the earth in glory, he will come to the earth in glory with his saints to judge the wicked and to destroy the man of sin. To destroy the man of sin. We see that in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering unto him, that you be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the heavens, he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now you know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of the iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall the wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness." So Paul wrote both these epistles to the believers at Thessalonica, who were primarily from the Greek background. And in the first letter to the Thessalonians, he tells us that most of them were idol worshippers. So now we look at chapter 2 of 2 Thessalonians, and we try to figure out and understand more about the second phase of Christ's coming. The first phase is the rapture, when the saints that believed in the Lord Jesus Christ will be received up into the air to meet him in the clouds. But before that, those that died in the Lord Jesus Christ, they will rise up first, and the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and the voice of the archangel and the trump of God will sound, and then we will be caught up in the air to meet the Lord Jesus Christ in the clouds. But in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, we're going to look at verses 1 and 2. Paul says, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by your gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that day of Christ is at hand." Some Thessalonian believers believed that the second coming had passed them by. Paul states that they were not to believe such teaching. In verse 3, Paul says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there be a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." So the Apostle Paul is affirming the believers in Thessalonica that they'd be not disheartened, thinking that Christ has already come and that they have been passed by, because he says, before Christ comes, in verse 3, the second phase, this is talking about the second phase of his second coming, there are some things that need to be, that need to take place. Some events that must needs happen before Christ comes in the second phase of his second coming. First of all, there must be a falling away. Let's look at verse 3. We said there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Falling away must come first. What is Paul referring to? Falling away could be a rebellion against God, an apostasy among the people of God, meaning they leave the faith and they deny the faith and they go back. A general defection from the truth during this time. This rebellious apostasy would prepare the way for the Antichrist to come. Some translate the word falling away as departure and understand it to be a reference to the rapture. You see, after Christ comes, when Christ comes the second time, when you study the book of Revelation, chapters 1, 2, and 3, beginning at chapter 4, we see that God begins to pour out of his judgment. There are 7 years of what the Bible calls the period of, or scholars call, the period of tribulation. These 7 years can be divided into two, the first 3.5 years and the next 3.5 years. The first 3.5 years are referred to as the time of tribulation, and the second 3.5 years are referred to as the time of great tribulation. So the believers believe that the church of Jesus Christ will be caught up, will be raptured before God begins to throw down and send down his judgments upon this wicked, unbelieving world and people. So with Paul, some translate the falling away as departure and understand it to be a reference to the rapture, meaning the man of sin cannot be revealed until Christ comes to take his church to be with him. It is an event that must happen before the man of sin is revealed. Paul does not use the title Antichrist, but his description of him parallels John's description of the Antichrist. The man of sin will lead the world into rebellion against God. We look at verse 10. It says, let's look at verse 4. "Who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he is God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God." So what's going on here? It says that before Christ's second phase of his second coming, you know, that man, the Antichrist, he is going to seat himself in the temple and he is going to demand worship from the people. It says, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God. He opposes God. He is God's biggest enemy. And he likes to take the place of God. He will seat himself in the temple and he will command and he will demand worship from people. Remember you not that when I was with you yet, I told you these things? And now you know what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time. There is, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. So Paul is saying here that the church of Jesus Christ is the hinderer that keeps the Antichrist from surfacing in the front. As soon as Christ comes and this Antichrist is revealed, before that, the church of Christ will be raptured in the first phase of his second coming. It says here in verse 7, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. We know that the spirit of Antichrist is already here. The Apostle John, in his epistles, First John, Second John, he talks and he makes reference to the spirit of Antichrist. It has been there for the longest time, and it has been in the works for the longest time, but all of it will culminate in the person of the Antichrist. Verse 8, and then shall the wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. When Christ Jesus will come again, then what will happen? He will bind the powers of darkness, and Satan, Antichrist, and the beast, they will be put in the lake of fire forever. Verse 8, and then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Amen. You see, this Antichrist, verse 9 says, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all powers and signs and lying wonders. He will deceive the people during those days of great tribulation, so much so that they will believe that he is God and he is above God, or he has all the power that is equal to God's power. This evil, deceptive Antichrist will be dealt with when Christ comes during the second phase of his second coming. Glory, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. He will perform wonders and he will perform signs. Something like, not quite, but not as bad. You know, I mean, what I'm going to say is not as bad as what's yet to come. You remember in the court of Pharaoh, when God sent Moses to ask Pharaoh to release God's people so that God's people could worship God, you know, deliver them from Egypt and worship God, Pharaoh resisted Moses. And Pharaoh's prophets, or the magicians that were there in Pharaoh's court, they all came. When Moses put his rod down and it turned to a snake, then all the magicians put down their rods, and there were one too many snakes crawling all over the court. And it was kind of frightening. I'm sure Moses must have thought, God, what kind of joke is this? But we read from God's word that within moments, Moses' snake swallowed up all the snakes of Pharaoh's magicians. So that way, here, Satan or the Antichrist is going to do wonders and is going to do miracles, so much so that he will deceive even the very elect, it says. But God will ultimately take care of him and destroy him completely. Amen. Because before that, prior to that, we read that he will pretend to be God because he wants to be worshipped. He will proclaim himself to be divine and will sit in the temple of God acting as if he is God. Though many men have wanted to be gods, that's not something new. Of course, the Antichrist, as I said, is a climax, and he is the one in whom all these powers come up to the highest. But there have been men that have been wanted to be gods. The true God became a man. Listen carefully. Interesting. The true God became a man and humbled himself and redeemed us through the shedding of his own blood. But men who are men, they want to become God, and they have no humility, but they are just the opposite of a humble spirit. The one who deserves all worship and praise does not command worship. How interesting. But came as a servant. This man of sin, on the contrary, will stand in the temple in Jerusalem and declare himself to be God, the ultimate fulfillment of the abomination of desolation spoken of by the prophet Daniel and also by Jesus himself. Verse 7, he will be taken out of the way. This is referring to Satan. First John and verse 2 and 18, the spirit of Antichrist is already at work, the restrainer. The church will be taken out of the way when the rapture takes place. The prayer of, what is it that's hindering the Antichrist right now? It is the church. It is the prayer of saints that keeps the enemy's power from coming fully to the forefront. It is the influence of saints that keeps the power of the Antichrist from coming out completely in all its force and power. We are the salt of the earth, and we are the light of the world. And as long as the church is here on the earth, Satan or Antichrist will not be able to come out as he is going to come after the rapture of the church takes place. Amen. He will be destroyed by Christ and cast into the lake of fire. That's Revelation chapter 13, verse 7, and Revelation 19 and 20 says, when the Lord comes, then the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet, and worked signs in his presence by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These two were cast alive in the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. Glory, hallelujah. And verse 12, unbelievers shall share the condemnation of those who rejected the truth and took pleasure in unrighteousness. Rejection of the gospel results in condemnation. Let me say that again. Rejection of the gospel, rejection of Jesus Christ will end in condemnation. Christ Jesus did not come to condemn us, but he came to save us. But when we reject him, John's Gospel chapter 3 verses 16, 17, 18 says that when we reject Christ, we will be automatically condemned. Now I'd like to compare the two phases of Christ's second coming. First, for the comfort and encouragement of Christ's saints. That's why Jesus came the first phase of his second coming. The second phase of his coming, it tells of coming judgment on Christ's foes or enemies. In the first phase, first phase relates to the church. The second phase of Christ's coming relates to the world. The first speaks of parousia, chapter 4 and verse 15. And the coming of the Lord, it talks about the coming of the Lord, that is in 1 Thessalonians. The second of the apocalypse, Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7, when the Lord Jesus Christ shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. In the first, he will come in the air. In the second, he will come to the earth. In the first, the day of Christ is referred to as the day of Christ, Philippians chapter 1 and verse 10, and the second is referred to as the day of the Lord. In Scripture, anytime, any place we read the day of the Lord, it is a reference to the judgment of God, the wrath of God being poured out. My dear friends, those of you that are listening to us today, those of you that are listening to me today, will you kindly take this message seriously? Will you take this gospel seriously? You know, I travel very often by the grace of God, and I hop from one plane into another and go different places, and I know many of you do that too. But I remember the first time that I got into a plane, I was so attentive to what the air hostess had to say. This was many years ago, and my eyes were fixed on this air hostess. And she said, in the case of an emergency, she started pointing out to all the exit doors. She says, there are two behind, there are two at the back, and there are two on this side, and then there are two in the middle, you know. And she was giving all these instructions. Should we have experience air pressure than what you're supposed to do? And in the case of a, you know, real danger or some a calamity, then what we're supposed to follow, and all of those things were given. And I just listened, glued to my seat, making sure that I took in every detail for my own safety. And then I started traveling again, and I listened the second time, and I listened the third time. But you know, I've gotten so used to this message from the air hostesses. Although the airlines may be different and the destinations are different, I have gotten so used to that now I've kind of become thick-skinned. I'm callous. I don't listen anymore, because I say, you know what? I know what she's going to say, and I know what to look for. And sometimes, even us believers, we might hear this message of Christ's second coming too often and too many times that we may become callous. But the Lord Jesus Christ warns us, I come like a thief. Behold, I come like a thief in the night. What does that mean? Jesus Christ wants us to be ready all the time, 24/7. May we not become like the passengers that travel by air, that get so used to and know all the instructions that the air hostess is about to give that we don't even pay attention. This is not flying in an airplane. This is more dangerous than any plane crashing, and you're a passenger in that plane. This is about life and death. I trust and pray you will accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and as your Lord today, and that you will give your heart and you will pay attention to this message, because Jesus is coming soon. He's coming the second time to punish those that have lived ungodly lives, unrighteous lives, those that have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. We want to give you one chance again today to accept the Lord Jesus Christ and to believe in Him. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank You and we praise You for this day that You've given to us, for this message, Lord, this forewarning that You've given to us in Your Word, that indeed You are coming. You have given us so many signs about Your coming, and we see them all being fulfilled before our eyes. I pray, Lord, that You will help every listener today to accept You as their Savior and their Lord. To Lord Jesus, to believe Your Word and to live according to Your Word, that they will escape the wrath of God. You took our wrath upon Yourself on the cross. Give us simple faith, we pray, to accept, to believe. And we will give You praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. If you would like to contact us with any other information, our phone number is there, 626-818-6494. Please pray for us. We appreciate your prayer and support us if you can. Our P.O. Box is 40394 Pasadena, California, 91114. The Lord bless you, and the Lord prepare you, and the Lord make you ready for His glorious second coming. Thank you, and God bless.